Here today we'll start with a little about AOR exam, and then we'll try to know what is his areas of practice, and Rohan will also tell us about his experience in the corporate world. So I give the stage to Rohan. Rohan, let's start the seminar, and we thank you very much for giving your valuable time. I know you're very busy on the Sunday also, we very much thank you so that like we could have your time and here for the seminar. So let's start the seminar. Rohan, on to you.
Thank you, Abhilash, for that so kind of an introduction. And I think one closely guarded secret that you've not mentioned to your students is that we were roommates as well. And it's a pleasure to be with you, and thank you for this warm invitation and warm welcome. And I'm happy to be amidst our students again. It feels like I'm back in college after a long, long time. So I think all of you know me by now to at least some extent. But today I'll discuss with you on, at a very brief level, just to give you an idea about what the AOR exam is, rather what or why should you go for an AOR exam? That's most important. So as we all know that in comparison to Supreme Court, other high courts, district courts, there is no per se qualification or an eligibility criteria that you require in case you want to file something in those courts or appear in those courts. As far as Supreme Court is concerned, the Supreme Court rules specifically require that you have to be a registered or a qualified advocate on record. That is the first qualification that you require before you can file something in your own name before the Supreme Court. And that is how the requirement of an advocate on record comes into the picture. Now, every year, this examination happens in the month of June, July. It's also happening this year. And this exam requires some bit of preparation. It becomes tough because most of the people who have to appear for this exam have to be undergoing some kind of practice or the other. So it becomes a juggling task for all of us to manage work as well as to study for exams. And that is why some people call it challenging, it's grueling, and et cetera, et cetera. So this is pretty much about an AOR exam and what it takes. Now, we mentioned why one should go for an AOR exam. Obviously, the first is the eligibility criteria. But beyond that is, why do you want to make a practice in Supreme Court? And why not confine yourself to district court or high court? So what my experience has been so far, that if one practices in Delhi extensively, then one matter or the other eventually find its way up to the Supreme Court. And if you happen to be that person or advocate who's been handling the matter right from the scratch, right from district court to high court, and if you're not in AOR, then you have to end up engaging an AOR who's going to file the appeal in the Supreme Court on its own name. That is why many of us, at least in Delhi, decide that over time, once you've gathered enough experience, one should take the AOR exam. Now, first I'll go into what are the eligibility criteria for taking an AOR exam. The minimum requirement, first of all, is to have a 5-year practice, prior practice, before you can even take the exam. Out of which, the last 1 year has to be some form of apprenticeship or tutelage under an AOR who's had more than 10 years of experience. So in short, if you're in your fourth year, or if you've exceeded your fourth year of practice, then what you have to do is, you have to get yourself enrolled with an AOR having more than 10 years of experience.
Rohan, we all have only 3 LLB students here.
Okay. Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Abhilash, for that. So eventually when you, of course, graduate and you've spent 4 years at the bar, then you can obviously get yourself enrolled under an AOR who's got more than 10 years of experience, and then take the exam. Now, this exam, which happens around June, July every year, is divided essentially into four parts. The first part is called drafting. The second is called legal ethics. The third is called practice and procedure. And the fourth is called important decisions of the Supreme Court. Now I'll explain what each of these subjects entails and why it's been structured this way. So the moment your matter comes up into Supreme Court, what is the first thing that we need to understand? Is whether this is a case which is fit to go and appeal before the Supreme Court. Because Supreme Court, unlike other courts, is the last court of appeal. It is certainly not going to go into issues of facts at that stage. And as the apex court, it is only concerned primarily with questions of law. And in some cases, substantial questions of law. So that is why one of the subjects in the course of an AOR is important decisions of the Supreme Court, which are essentially your landmark decisions on constitution, on criminal law, on arbitration, nowadays insolvency, company law, etc. So this gives you a brief flavor, or rather a wide spectrum, of what are the settled principles in many of these spheres, so that when a case comes to you in the field of, let's say, insolvency or in the field of arbitration, you're already to some extent. This is one of the things. The second comes to think for filing an appeal. What are the formalities or the technical requirements I need to keep in mind before I file something? And just so that my appeal doesn't get rejected because of defects. There are questions I think heard in balance we hear, it's called a judge's roster for a particular court. And just like our high court, district courts have their own rosters, so does the Supreme Court. So this practice and procedure helps you decide what are the procedural requirements for filing, for maintaining an appeal, and at the same time, before which court, forum within those courts in the Supreme Court, where the appeal will lie. Hence, the second subject is practice and procedure. Now, I've covered both the substantive law part of it, which is your landmark decisions, and I've also broadly covered the practice and procedure of Supreme Court. The third important subject is actually preparing the appeal. So they have a drafting exam. And the idea of a drafting exam is to test your memory knowledge as well as your drafting skills on how you will go about preparing an appeal. Nowadays, of course, we are all using computers. We are using so-called copy-pasting, preparing affidavits within 5 minutes. But during that exam, and that's really a test of your character, so to speak, you have to prepare all that drafting by hand. And I can tell you honestly, my handwriting, and Abhilash knows, is worse than that of a doctor. So for me, this was the toughest exam possible. The third exam that they normally have is the drafting exam, where they ask you to draft in those two and a half hours. A special leave to appeal, or a civil appeal, or a criminal appeal with their ingredients or components. So that's really a big test, and it's considered to be one of the most difficult tests that is administered by the Supreme Court Bar Association. Now, this takes care of the three subjects. Now, with everything they want, at least Supreme Court believes that there should be people of upright character. There should be people who believe in the virtues of law and are not just there to purely service a client. That is the distinction which the Supreme Court tries to make over our other courts. And that's why they have an exam called the legal ethics exam. And if you all remember, perhaps this legal ethics and jurisprudence might be a subject for all of you. It's that boring, thin book which talks about all the big values that we should not do this for the client, we should do this for the adversary. Those are the principles that one needs to keep in mind. But at the Supreme Court level, these principles acquire a different shape and size, and they want what kind of legal ethic challenges, or how can one advocate handle legal ethic challenges if it comes about in a Supreme Court matter? It could be anything from a conflict that you might have with a client. It could be anything in relation to you getting to know about your client doing something which they are not supposed to be doing, to simply a small matter of not disclosing a fact before the Supreme Court. So it's to ensure that people of good character, so to speak, come before Supreme Court. They still have that legal ethic exam today. Now, these are the four exams that one has to participate in. And only if you clear in all of them with an average of 50 or more, you get entitled to be qualified as an AOR. The important caveat is that if in any of the examination your marks fall below 50, then you have to take all these examinations once again. And as of now, in the rules at least, there are only 3 attempts so that for qualifying as an AOR. So if you don't get, if you get struck out on the first go, then you have the remaining 2 attempts. So this is broadly about your eligibility criteria.
Because I have seen it as like 5 attempts we have.
Hi, Krupa. Sorry, you have a question?
Is it like a 3 attempts we have or 5 attempts?
No, as of now, the latest one which had come, there were only 3 attempts. There are slightly different rules in for people who are from Bombay. They have a criteria. I know people who have already qualified for the solicitor exam. But to the best of my knowledge, and I can stand corrected, it's 3 attempts.
Okay.
So 3 attempts should be taken in with a limited time, in a limited time frame, or you have like...
Yes, it has to be one of the next year itself.
Okay. Within 3 years, you have to clear the AOR exam.
Yeah. So in case the moment you get to know you're not qualified for one exam, the Supreme Court normally comes out with a circular itself around the examination point of time, where they say that if you do not clear, you undertake to participate in the next year's exam itself, failing which all of the other papers that you've taken, those scores become null and void. So you have to take them again. And they keep revising the criteria. It actually depends on the examination committee, which comprises the Supreme Court senior advocates. Okay, one thing which I actually forgot to tell you all is that normally there are no classes for preparing for these examinations. Like Abhilash is kind enough to take you hours and hours of teaching, condense it and present it to you. That kind of scholastic learning is not available. It's a self-learning program in that sense. You have to prepare on your own while you're working and make the most out of it. One thing important which does happen is that just about 3 to 4 weeks before the examination, there are lectures on each of these subjects. Now, these lectures are taken by the examiners themselves. So it becomes very important to attend those lectures and understand what kind of questions might come our way. Some of the examiners are, you can call them lenient enough, and they will give you some hints of these are the questions or these are the topics which might come. So it's important to attend those lectures, understand what the paper pattern will be, what kind of questions might come, if there's any change in the paper pattern, and grasp as much as you can. So that is one source of knowledge or repository of knowledge that one has to look after besides your self-learning. The second is the website itself. So if any one of you has gone to the Supreme Court, logged on to the Supreme Court website, on the left-hand side, in the tabs, there is an AOR section. So in that AOR section, you will find all past year's papers, the reading material which is there for the current year, and some other relevant material. So it becomes extremely important for anyone who's participating or taking the exam to go through that link to download all the last year, 10 years papers, use them to understand what kind of questions have been there in the past and what can come in the next year or the current year. So apart from your own learning, looking at the website and looking at and attending at these sessions conducted by the examiners becomes very, very important. And hopefully once you graduate, you can ask your employer for some leave so that you can prepare and work well and clear the exam in one go.
Yes, Krupa.
Hi, Rohan. So if one fails in all the four subjects, and then he will not be eligible for the next exams, right?
He gets two attempts more, Krupa.
I think one fails in all the fours in one time, then he cannot apply. Then that's what I have somewhere.
If you fail, I'm not sure, Krupa, if you fail in all four, I can check that and get back to you. But if you fail in all four, then perhaps you might get another attempt. On that second attempt, I can check and get back to you.
Okay, cool.
So this is broadly about what an AOR exam entails. Now, a little bit about the practice side of it.
Rohan, a quick question before you move on to the So is there any age limitation to take this examination? We are working, and then see, we have enrolled, we are studying law now, for particularly me and a few more candidates, and in future we would like to practice when the opportunity comes. And is there any age criteria that bars to take this exam?
Krupa, I think are you talking about the age
criteria? Yeah, age limit. Is there any age limit?
There is an age limit, to the best of my knowledge. I think it's in the age of 40s, if I'm not mistaken. If you can give me 5 minutes, I think during the course of the seminar, I'll bring up the age part also.
Yeah, no issues, Rohan. You can just share the link of that website so students will gain more out of it.
Absolutely. But I understand from your question, Nagamesh, that you are trying to look at enrolling yourself at a later stage.
Absolutely.
Okay. So, there are people, of course, I know practically, when we were preparing for the exam, there were people in their 40s who were still taking the exam. And there's absolutely, therefore, no bar in that sense. But here's my thing, my own input. Unless we are going to make practical use of this qualification, I personally am not of the view that we should collect qualifications or degrees just for the sake of it, just so that it looks great on your CV, on your resume. The idea is actually to make use of that qualification and enhance your practice. So that is why now, according to me, I'll speak about 5 minutes or 10 minutes on what the practical side of it is. So let's say you've passed with flying colors, or you've cleared your examination in one go, and now you're here to practice. So what happens? Does anything magical happen when you suddenly clear the AOR? In my experience, no. So even this year, last year, 2019, when the results came out in 2020, out of about 900 people, 200 people still qualified. That's still not a bad average or a percentage of people who've passed. Out of those lots, it's not like everyone is doing Supreme Court work. So therefore, one important thing I must confess, that just clearing the AOR exam does not mean you start getting Supreme Court related work. It's a gradual process where people, your peers, they get to know that you are an AOR. They start referring matters to you. There might be some matters in which you may handle in the future, which were at the high court level, but they were eventually had to be appealed before the Supreme Court. So in those cases, you can file something on your own. So once you qualify as an AOR, the next step is actually building your own practice in the Supreme Court. And I'm sure we've all heard of popular names in the Supreme Court circle. Firms like Karanjawala, firms like Agarwal Law Associates, and many more. These are the firms who are, by registration and qualification, AOR registered firms. And I'll come to this concept also, what is AOR registered firm? But broadly speaking, these are the firms who are doing a lot of Supreme Court filing work. In fact, the work is so much that they're sustaining their entire practice on just one forum. So coming back to the AOR registered firm aspect. So once you've qualified as an AOR, you have two options. If you know another colleague of yours who's also an AOR, both of you can come together and form a registered AOR firm. And that firm is like any other law firm with a plus or an added advantage that firm can, on the name of the firm itself, make all filings before the Supreme Court. So you can either make a filing in your own individual name as an AOR, or you can file as a firm, which is a registered AOR firm.
Yes, Som Shankar, sir. What is your doubt? So Som Shankar, okay. Okay, Rohan, you can continue. Yeah,
so this is pretty much my personal experience on AOR practice. The key, of course, to a successful AOR practice, and I'm many years behind that, honestly speaking, is to understand your benches. Now, a Supreme Court usually is structured in a way that every court is a division bench, where there are two judges sitting, except for the Chief's Court, which is court number one. That is the court where three judges sit together. One is the Chief, and there are two puni judges who sit along with him. And that is therefore a bench where there are three judges sitting otherwise. So it's important to understand, and this only comes, I think, after one starts appearing before the Supreme Court regularly, is what kind of judges are there, whether they have a short temperament, whether they can give you a patient hearing, what are the inclinations of those judges. Those are important aspects which help us understand, as in when the matter comes up, how do you assess what's going to happen in your matter? Nobody knows for sure how that particular judge on that particular day might behave in your matter, or what is the kind of relief that might come. But once you grasp an understanding of what are the different kinds of benches, especially in your line of work, in your field of work, then you get a fair bit of idea about how or what will happen in those kind of matters. So understanding the benches, going through the rosters is extremely important. The second tool I feel is, and I'm not sure many people, if they take benefit of that. Okay, can anyone answer this question? I'm sure you guys would know this. How does Live Law and Bar and Bench tell you about the latest Supreme Court cases the moment they come out? Does anyone want to answer that?
Probably there is some in-hand person inside there in the courtroom.
I figured. So Pankaj, you have a conspiracy theory. Anyone else with a conspiracy theory like this? Okay, any ideas about how do they get to know that this is the judgment which is coming? Okay, I'll give you a short answer. In fact, Pankaj is right to some extent. there are people, of course, from the press who are watching matters on a day-to-day basis. So they're, of course, aware of this. But how can a layman, or let's say someone who's interested in Supreme Court practice, understand what's the latest judgment? So on the Supreme Court website itself, the moment you log in at the home page, there is something called a latest judgment tab. So every day, whatever the new judgments, whether they are reportable or not reportable, they get uploaded. And it starts flashing, at least the more important ones, they start flashing on the latest judgment tab. So if you're interested in to understand what are the key developments or which is the latest judgment which is out, the first recourse should be to go to that latest judgment tab and see which is the latest criminal judgment, which is the latest judgment on arbitration or on civil law. So that's how even bar and bench and live law, in matters which may not be of high media value, they use that latest judgment tab to pull out the judgment and report on it. So that is another effective tool for anyone who's interested in understanding the key Supreme Court developments which happen from time to time.
Otherwise, there are journals published or Supreme Court online cases, and there are Supreme AIR reporter who publish judgments. Through that also, everyone comes to know about the judgments, I guess.
Absolutely, absolutely. Abhilash, you're absolutely right. There are AIR manuals, SCR manuals which publish them. But the fastest way, if someone really wants to know, is the latest judgment tab on the website, where the moment it's uploaded, it starts flashing. By the time it comes to SEC online or AIR manual, etc., it takes about a week, 10 days, or maybe 2 weeks.
Okay.
So that is on the practical side of things. So if you have any questions on this AOR portion of it, I'm happy to answer them. Or we can move on, subject to what Abhilash has to say, on my little experience on the corporate side of things.
Anyone has any doubts?
Yeah, when they file something on the registry and all, it's the AOR, right, who looks into all the, I mean, the filing issues and all, and he's the one. Before, I heard like before a matter goes to Supreme Court, the AOR is someone who talks to the registry, the errors are being sorted out and all. So does it go directly to the bench, or the, is it like it goes to the registry first, then things, and who decides which bench it goes and all? And we all know Chief Justice is the roster of, he's the master of the roster. But how does it happen? Like, how's the process actually?
Absolutely, Pankaj. So I see there are two questions, one regarding the filing part of it and the other regarding the listing part of it. So I'll answer both one by one. As far as the filing is concerned, now let me talk about the pre-COVID era. In the pre-COVID era, where we did not have online filing, the typical procedure was that you prepare the file with the help of your clerk, you file it with the registry. Normal filings can be filed up till 5 p.m. of that particular day, on working days, of course. And if there is some urgent filing, then it can be done by 7 p.m. That requires some other procedure, but you can stretch it in some cases to 7 p.m. Now, once you file it, what happens is, there is a person who's called a scrutinizer. He belongs to a department called the scrutiny department. Now, just like the roster, which we spoke about, the scrutiny department is also divided into different subject codes. For example, if there is an arbitration matter, there is a subject code assigned to arbitration, which is in the series of 4000. So if it's an arbitration matter, you will disclose that in your Supreme Court filing, that this is an arbitration matter and this is the subject code, which is usually about 4 digits. Based on that, the scrutiny department, at least one portion of the scrutiny department, which is looking into arbitration matter, is seized with your file. Now, out of that department, a scrutinizer is appointed who's specifically looking at your file. And that is the person who first goes through your file and notifies you or your court clerk of the defects. Once the defects have been notified to you, and in the physical filing days, what used to happen is you either used to get a phone call, or if your clerk is already loitering around in the Supreme Court gallery, he will go and check after a few hours and find out whether the file has been scrutinized or not. Once the defects have been notified, you have 14 days to cure the defect. If you fail to do it within 14 days, of course, it becomes a fresh filing. You have to refile it. But within those 14 days, you have the option of curing the defect, either by replacing some page numbers, etc. Now, once you do that, the scrutinizer receives the file back. It checks whether all the defects have been properly removed. If not, it will give the file back again to you. If yes, then it will send it to the next department, which is the Department of Registration. Now, that is the department which is headed by the Registrar General. Now, in that department, there might be some assistant registrar who looks into your file. He will see the scrutinizer's report, and once he finds everything is okay, he will assign a number to your case, which we normally call a diary number. Once you have the diary number with you, it means that it has been accepted. It means it has been scrutinized. At least that's what used to happen in the good old days. I tell you how the procedure has slightly changed now. And once the diary number has been assigned and it's been cleared by the registry, the matter will then go to the third department, which is the listing department. Now, the listing department follows the directions of the Chief Justice. Now, there is already a judge roster which is given out. But you asked a very valid question, Pankaj. What happens if there are two judges who are handling consumer matters? How do we know before which judge to go? So that is something which is completely internal. It is not disclosed to us. And our experience tells us that it's already been decided either on the basis of an odd even number, that the first file will go to this and the second file will go to this, or some other method which the judges...
What is the time duration the roster changes, the judge roster changes every time in Supreme Court?
Yeah, so the judge roster is dependent on two factors. If there is a shuffle in the benches,
okay.
For example, a new judge has been inducted from the High Court,
okay.
Then immediately after that, there will be a roster within one day.
Okay. Here in Karnataka, we have a 90 days time. In every 90 days, they change the roster, role of judge to look into different matters, maybe educational, maybe state-related matters, or maybe criminal matters. For everything, there's a roster will change here on 90 days. Judges, their roles will change. Here how it is in Karnataka. Coming to that strict part of scrutiny, the only strict scrutiny I have seen here with this CAT, Central Appellate Tribunal, with regard to central government services. There they check line by line, spelling mistakes. They check into that extent. Comma, full stop, and all the grammatical errors, which is totally not allowed while filing before Central Appellate Tribunal. Here, High Court, Civil Courts, minor errors, mistakes are allowed while drafting. This is what I find here in Karnataka. But it's interesting to know that Supreme Court also follows such type of steps in scrutinizing files.
Yeah, that's in fact an interesting thing I was not aware of, that even spellings and commas full stop are checked.
Yes.
So I can tell you Supreme Court doesn't get into that level of checking. So
yes,
that's more of an editor's job. So
yeah,
the registry, I don't think so, is well equipped.
I don't know with other state government CAT appellate tribunals, but Karnataka Central Appellate Tribunal for Central Government Services is quite strict here. Because many times we have brought the files back twice to re-edit and submit again. So, which is very tedious job here in Karnataka when we are handling service matters, government employees matters with regard to central government. Yep. Yeah, Rohan.
Yeah.
Yes, Pankaj, you have anything to ask?
Yeah, nothing. It's been answered.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry, Pankaj, just to answer your last question about the listing, as I mentioned, you can get a fair bit of idea from the roster, but if there are two or more judges who handle the same kind of matters, there is no, let me call it, straight way to get to know before which judge the matter will come.
Yeah, it has been in news with students also. Like the past year, we had some issues, right?
But the interesting thing is, some matters got listed quite fast.
And some usually don't get listed. So that is something which keeps on, like, as students, we keep on thinking, why does one matter get listed and another matter? So this is something which is, you know, very much vague in the media. But general people also do ask us. So we are not able to answer this question, why it actually happens. I mean, I'm talking about a particular personality which happened in last year. So that was quite in news. A particular media personality.
Absolutely. In fact, I can tell you my own personal experience in High Court. I don't know whether that's of relevance to you, but even like last month, we were also trying to struggle and identify before which court will our matter come up. It was a commercial Section 9 under the Arbitration Act proceeding. And there were three judges who had that roster. So quite frankly, there was no straight way to identify. But from the grapevine, we got to know that there is obviously a judge in charge at the original level. And that judge in charge has developed its own protocol of how to assign judges. And they follow what you can call an odd even method or how the files are stacked. So let's say the top file will go to Justice Bhakru. The second file will go to some other judge. And the third file will go to some other judge. And they repeat the pattern over and over again. Unless, of course, there is some other request or there is a case of recusal by a judge.
Do they disclose this during the collegium meetings? I mean, some things do come on the Supreme Court website and all. Do they disclose all these things in the collegium?
No, not at all. This is not disclosed.
How it is assigned and all. Okay, thank you.
No, there's so some portions of Supreme Court practice and procedure are still not 100% transparent. Okay. But this is as far as any common man or any lawyer can get to know from the website.
With a general question, when a judge is moving on a rotation, how they evaluate, suppose, criminal to civil, civil to other cases?
Brahma, sorry, I didn't get your question. Can you repeat that one?
Okay. When judges are moving on rotation, to give a judgment, they need a fully understanding of the petition to give a judgment, right?
Yeah.
When they move from civil to criminal to other government services, whatever, how they will handle it, the situational things?
Brahma sir, judge has to look into all affairs, all matters. Generally, this is how it works in here. Except the CJA, Chief Justice of Karnataka, he has specific matters which is under his scrutiny. All state matters go to him. But remaining consumer, family matters, other white collar crimes, here how it is. Here the roster gets divided only for the other judges. But the Chief Justice of Karnataka in High Court, his matters will be the same. His roster will not get changed. Is it the same, Rohan, in Supreme Court? Like Chief Justice of India will have the specific matter locked for him?
Because the Chief Justice is the master of the roster and master of the roles, the Chief Justice decides what kind of matters will go before the Chief Justice and the other two judges with him, as well as for the other judges. So the roster is usually released by the Chief Justice itself. So there's a good possibility that certain commercial matters, certain, let's say, land acquisition matters or any other matter per se, which may otherwise be not before him, can also be taken by him for sound reasons. But at least as far as to answer, I think, Brahma's question, when we talk about Supreme Court, the judges who are inducted, they already have a lot of depth and breadth in terms of civil criminal law or for that matter, commercial laws nowadays, which is arbitration, not so much IBC. IBC is still fairly new. But all these judges have sufficient amount of experience. There are also judges who come from the bar. And those are prominent lawyers. For example, Justice Indu Malhotra was one of them who got elevated and she retired very recently. So Justice Indu Malhotra has had a fairly good amount of practice in commercial law, service law, and other matters. So these are people of eminence who understand what are the different nuances. And when they start rotating from one bench to another in Supreme Court, that is only a sign that the judge is moving towards seniority. So the idea of a new judge is one of whoever is inducted in the Supreme Court, that new judge is assigned either a seat next to the chief. That depends on how the chief wants to go about it. There is no science behind it. Or it might go with the judge sitting in court number 14 or 15 for that matter. And all the courts are arranged generally in a way that they're arranged as per seniority. So typically the senior most judge would be in court one. The next in line would be in court two, who is now going to be similar to our case where right now the judge in court number two is going to take over the reins as the next chief justice on 23rd of April, 2021. And likewise, the person sitting in the last courtrooms will be the younger most judge. And the more they come closer in terms of their numbers, it means that they are gaining seniority or seniorship in terms of the Supreme Court roster itself.
Any more doubts from anyone? Yes, Bindu.
Hi, Rohan. This is Bindu. I have a question which kind of has been bothering me. Can you hear me? Are you able to hear me?
Yeah, Bindu, I can hear you.
Okay, great. Yeah. As far as I understand, the most of the lawyers in the Supreme Court are from Delhi is what I have gathered. So what about people from other states? Do they actually relocate or how does it work? Coming from your experience, I'm sure you would have interacted with many people like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So there are two kinds of lawyers who come to Supreme Court. One are your senior advocates who may have had a roaring practice, let's say in their own home state, such as Mr. Shyam Diwan, who was a fairly successful counsel in Bombay before he shifted to Delhi. And now he's a bigger name than many people. For example, Mr. Arvind Datta, who's based in Chennai, had extremely good practice and now has relocated to Delhi for quite some time now. You have Mr. C.A. Sundaram also, who's from Chennai, Mr. Mohan Parasaran also from Chennai. So all these people have come to Delhi because they ultimately felt that, let's say they've touched the glass ceiling in their respective hometowns and they want to see what is the next big thing. And perhaps Supreme Court offers that. So those are one category of advocates are senior counsels. The second category of advocates are people who have either shifted way in advance from their hometown to Delhi because they felt that Delhi is where all the litigation is for whatever reason, right or wrong. And those are the people who have started in Delhi, developed themselves. So in that sense, after a few years, they have an even advantage or a level playing field compared to anyone who's been in Delhi long enough or was originally from Delhi. And then, of course, there are people, let's say from Bangalore. I think, Abhilash, you would have heard of that law firm which is there in Bangalore, the Povaiya.
Yes, Povaiya. Yeah,
Povaiya. And I think one of our friends, Gurpreet, is now working there. So they have established offices from sitting in Bangalore, now in Delhi, and they have a good practice. And they're catering to the Delhi Supreme Court Circle and Delhi High Court. So this is the second category of people who decided that most of the work or some high-value litigation is going to happen in Delhi. So it's better to have your base in Delhi. So that's how people normally structure their practices.
Yes, we have two juniors who practice with my father, who are now in Delhi. My father regularly sends cases to him if there are any Supreme Court matters. I don't remember the name. They were 10 years back, I think so. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's also an example. Yeah. Amlash, you're right.
This is a specific question related to the next, post-COVID era, things, how would things be? Like, we have heard, Justice DYC, DY Center, he heads an e-committee on things, and he wants to make something flexible, and he's saying, some matters would be physically heard and some matters would go to the online forum. So, how are things going to change? How are things going to change probably in the next couple of years or, things ahead? It will be both physical and, the online hearing or the natural things would come back. Where do you see it?
Pankaj, I would like to answer your question. Especially with regard to high courts in Karnataka, now judges are mostly comfortable with online hearings. They love online hearings. They have become more comfortable on Zoom meeting and other Google Meet platforms here. So every court, they have a fixed ID for Zoom every day to log in for any. Only thing is the password will change every day. If any advocate has cases on that court, he'll get a message for that Zoom ID and password. He'll have to log in and sit from his home, and he can, when the case is called out, he can argue the matter. So this is how it works in Karnataka. They have made this facility available here in high courts, but they had started during COVID time, they had started this facility for lower courts, district courts also. But after when the courts opened, they stopped for district courts and it continued only with high courts. How is it in Supreme Court, Rohan? Only online hearings now?
So in Supreme Court, it's only online hearings.
Okay.
Since the lockdown, they have started using this app called the Video App, VIDYO. Mm-hmm. It's an indigenous developed app. And Supreme Court doesn't use Citrix or... certainly not Zoom call or Microsoft Teams, none of that. They use this app called Video App. And now, I think last 3 months back, they had launched a fresh version of that, which is far, far superior to the earlier version. And all the hearings are happening through this platform, whether it's for a small hearing or a full-fledged final argument where there are a barrage of senior counsels involved. All that is happening online. Now, I think to answer, was that Pankaj who asked that question? Sorry, was that?
Yes, Pankaj.
Yeah, so Pankaj, what's going to happen now, my own take, now I could be completely wrong and I don't have a crystal ball in front of me, could be that going forward, my own assessment, virtual will stay. It's only a question of the degree to which virtual will be there. Some might advocate that this current trend of all hearings happening through virtually might continue. My own take here is that we have felt over some time that physical hearings are required, especially when it comes to long drawn hearings, because there are so many documents which the judges have to go through and there are connection problems, there are network issues here in Delhi as well. Even in places like Bombay, Bangalore, I felt those network connections being an issue. So in hearings like this, it's a big risk or something one can't afford to do if the hearing gets interrupted. Let's say a senior counsel is making a good argument, but some network issue happens. You suddenly lose the pulse of the judge. And that's crucial in a matter when it comes to final arguments. So I feel perhaps going forward, a lot of procedural motions can be handled online. Simple notices have to be issued. Appearances have to be made before the registrar for completion of pleadings. All that doesn't require someone to personally go. As far as main hearings are concerned, they can or perhaps should be taken up on a case-to-case basis in the physical format. But will that happen in the next 2-3 months? I doubt it, because we've all seen what the conditions are now in India as far as COVID cases. So I don't see that happening, but maybe In the future, it will. But virtual is, according to me, here to stay.
Okay.
Any last questions for AOR exams? We'll start with the next topic about the corporate practice. Yes, Krupa.
Hi, Rohan. My question is, so in the stage of like fifth year of practice and the senior AOR, so the aspirant who are not like localites, how can they approach a senior AOR in Delhi?
Okay. That's a very pertinent question, and I've heard that question before as well. So what happens usually is that the whole industry, and you would know, I think, once you all start practicing as well, that it's all based on the strength of your network. And if you happen to know some colleague of yours who knows another senior AOR, that's the best way to approach. Cold calling another AOR may not help, but if you've got no network leads, there's nothing to lose. You can just drop them your CV, say that you generally want to work with them, and not just because they are AOR, but because you want to learn Supreme Court work, and you develop your association from there. So there are so many people I know, our own colleagues from our college, who started their careers within AOR itself in Supreme Court. So the first thing that they learned was Supreme Court drafting before they learned High Court or District Court drafting or any other. So those are the people, if they've worked for several years within AOR, that AOR will then give them that necessary certification which is required to participate. So these are perhaps the only two ways which come to my mind. But that, I think that posturing or which AOR to approach, one should start considering, at least in that start considering from the third year of practice where they want to go. But if you're already working with an AOR, the problem is solved.
So is it really difficult for the people who are outsiders?
Not necessarily, Krupa. You can practice under any high court advocate. Only thing is, Rohan, I just want to confirm from you, do we have to submit our wakalat records that for the 5 years we have practiced before approaching for AOR exam?
You need your employer certificate.
Employer certificate.
So in my case, I had to give two certificates from both my previous employers.
Okay.
Plus your, of course, your bar council certificate, your college degrees, all that is called for as part of the document processing.
Yes. So Krupa, your name should be in wakalat records of High Court. So if you have those records and the employer gives you certificate that you have appeared for so many matters before High Court and you are experienced with High Court practice, then I think it should be a clear way for you to approach for AOR exams. So, any last questions?
Hi, sir. This is Sridevi. Yes. Sir, my main concern is about the age limit for the AOR exam. Since there is no age limit for pursuing law, then I don't think there should be age limit for the exam too. Could you please clarify on the same?
Yeah, so I think while this was going on, I happened to check the Supreme Court rules also. You're right. I also am not able to locate any age limit in the Supreme Court rules. So perhaps you're right. There is no age limit for the purposes of taking the exam. But as I said, more than the age limit, it's the number of attempts you get. So let's say, hypothetically speaking right now, if the attempts are 3 or 5, whichever, and if you're not able to go through those attempts, then you will never be able to do it. Let's say you are within that age group. If you fail those attempts, then you will not be able to do it. But there is no outer limit. There is only a minimum limit of four years plus 1 year of training under an AOR. After that, there seems to be no outer limit.
Rohan, I have just shared in the common chat with regard to the Supreme Court website, that is with regard to AERO exam. And I have also shared Supreme Court rules 1966, which defines about advocate on record and all other things. I think students, please go through these documents in your free time. We can discuss with the next topic about Rohan's corporate practice. So,
yeah. Abhilash, may I also request if you could share the 2013 rules as well?
Okay, I'll share. I'll find out. Rohan, you can start with the next topic about your experience in corporate field with Amarchand, Mangalar Shroff and Shroff. So let's go with that topic.
Okay, you're right. I think after all these questions, I also started feeling that I'm taking the AER exam once again. Luckily, okay. I'm not drafting, so it's easier to just say it out.
Yeah.
So as far as my experience in the firm setup is concerned, I started my career with in the field of indirect tax litigation, where I used to work for this firm called Economic Laws Practice at the Delhi office. I worked there for a few years, then I shifted to Amarchand, Mangaldas and Shroff, as it was then called, before it became a Shardul Amarchand Shroff or SAMCO, as people colloquially call it. And in my experience of this firm environment, I have learned one thing, which is the art of becoming detail oriented and being meticulous with the job. That is something I feel that as a lawyer today, when I'm out on my own, that's an important skill set to have. It's an important skill set to develop and use that to display your work product to a client. The firm environment has had its own pressures, because after a point of time, when you're no longer a junior, you don't have the support in that sense or the shield in that sense of your senior. You have to start being able to not only execute the work, but also start sourcing work. And that's when the game becomes more difficult. So when you have to get work on your own, it's not only about, okay, I have these two deliverables on my table, I execute it, and that's the end of it. You're also being expected to look at what are the other clients you can have, what other field areas you can venture into. And that, of course, dictates your progress in the firm environment. So if any one of you right after you graduate, if you are thinking about whether one should work in a firm environment or should join an individual chamber, I would say that this is a life-changing decision. It should not be taken lightly. There should be some serious thought put behind it. And one of the governing considerations should be, what is your goal in the next 10 years from now? Where do you see yourself? Do you see yourself as a person who's going to be a senior advocate eventually, or who's going to become a partner in a law firm, or who might do both, or who might do none of these? So a lot of that will be dictated, or these are the governing considerations which will dictate the choice you make. But my general advice, and this might vary from a case-to-case scenario, my general advice would be that if you really want to learn complex litigation, something related to what's happening on a cutting-edge legal side, it's important to enter into a firm environment. Because one, you're not the only one who's there. You have other colleagues, you have their camaraderie, you have other aspects as well. Number two, you've entered an environment where everyone is learning some kind of a same skill set. I mean, if I take a exaggerated example of the Shaolin temple monks, so all of them have to go through those, I think, 18 gates or 36 gates of gruesome training. Similar to that is your law firm environment, where there are certain skill set that you must develop before you can actually handle a big litigation or prepare yourself for handling a matter which runs into tens of thousands of pages, etc. So that skill set will only can only be acquired in a place where that kind of work is happening. And there are limitations, I feel, with an individual advocate. There are pros and cons of that also. If you get lucky, you have a great boss, you have a great mentor, you have a great senior, then your life is sorted. That's what used to happen earlier as well. But now if I see the current trend, more and more lawyers are organizing themselves into teams. And those teams we call formally law firms. So an environment like that is pretty important. And even if being in a law firm is not your goal, that is certainly something of a place you should consider spending 2 to 3 years of your experience before you go into other areas. That would be, I think, my 2 cents on this. Other than that, I mean, there is so much which happens when you're working in a team. There's gossip, there are lunch breaks, there are non-legal stuff happening. So that's part and parcel of life.
So Rohan, anything like what type of clients you handle in Amarchand?
Okay, so in terms of clients, because Amarchand charges a certain level of fee, there are only certain kind of clients that get attracted to a firm like that, which are basically your corporates, the names that you hear about, your big brands, or HNIs, high net worth individuals who are who can afford that kind of legal fee. And it could be any corporate client for that matter. It could be, let's say, you know, as big as Tata to as unheard of as a private equity firm, which is not a common name, or even product related companies such as lift elevator, such as Otis, or all of these companies. These are all the clients which come to a firm like Amarchand, or for that matter, to other firms as well. So all these corporate clients nowadays have multiple law firms on their panel. So they don't like to put all their eggs in one basket. They might give some matters to, let's say, Amarchand, while on the other hand, they might give some matters to Luthra and to Triligan and all the Khetan and all these other firms. So these are generally the clients that I've handled in the past, and you can broadly categorize them as either corporate clients or HNIs who can afford that kind of legal fee. And my own personal experience, I think that's perhaps going to be Abhilash's follow-up question. I've had my own experience in about broadly 6 to 7 kinds of practice areas. So, but before that, I'll first define what practice areas currently are today in the market from a litigation perspective. So we know that there is a corporate side of things and there's a litigation side of things. These are broadly the two big verticals in which the legal market is divided. Corporates, we know mergers and acquisitions. We hear about Future getting acquired by Reliance or Amazon, deals happening, Flipkart, etc. mergers. So these all fall in the domain of mergers and acquisitions, or so to speak, corporate side of things. On the other hand, we have litigation, where I've spent almost all of my legal career so far. And that legal and that litigation practice area is broadly divided into two, civil and criminal. So that distinction is still today. Now, civil has expanded, so has criminal, but civil has expanded to take into account a so-called off-late kind of litigation, which we called corporate commercial litigation, which includes certain kinds of disputes. Number one, arbitration. Number two, insolvency bankruptcy code. Number three, what we call company-related litigations, or company law related litigation, which includes your operation and mismanagement. So if you, for example, last week, there was this big landmark judgment of the Tata Mystery corporate battle, which came out. So that is, of course, a landmark judgment in the area of operation and mismanagement. So that falls under company law related litigation. Then there are other sort, your typical civil suits are there, or now commercial suits. Then there are litigations which are arranged from an asset restructuring perspective. For example, if you're from the bank side, you might file litigations before DRT and debt recovery tribunals. That is another practice area. You might, if you're a creditor who's got security interest in your favor, you might file proceedings before SARFAESI under the SARFAESI Act, which is the Securitization Act. Then there are other fields of where consumer disputes happen. Now, consumer disputes nowadays, in terms of products and services, happen before your national consumer disputes or state disputes or district disputes. And now you also have a building related or builder related disputes, which are coming up before RERA, regulatory authority, regarding the buildings, regarding the construction disputes. So these are newer areas which are coming in the spectrum of commercial litigation, which is a subset of civil. Civil, of course, has other kinds of litigation. Your writ petitions which you file, there are some service-related matters, etc. So in the field of civil, if I talk about my own personal experience, it has been in the area of commercial litigation, which has these different sub-branches. I have not done much of criminal law. So if any one of you wants to follow that path, I may not be the right person. Perhaps I can connect you with...
I'm bringing Bharat next week.
Bharat will be a good guy. Yeah. I've had some experience in the white collar domain, which has a color of, you can say, commercial litigation attached to it, but that's pretty much. So that has been my limited experience so far. And I think over the years, I try and continue to expand the breadth of my practice area so that I can learn more. And so that when I'm called before an August gathering as yours, I'm able to show off that, you know, I've done much more work than before.
Rohan, one thing I would like to ask, like, if there is a privilege for you to discuss about any landmark case you handle of any company, and if it's not under NDA to disclose, you can discuss. So students would be interested to know, like, if there is any such case you handle of any big company or something like that.
Yeah, sure, Abhilash. So there is the judgment which I was talking about, which is the Tata Mistry battle. Now it's already out in the public domain. The judgment speaks for itself. So I was privileged to be part of this landmark case law or litigation, so to speak, which started about 5 years back in the year 2016, when the replacement of the former chairman of Tata Sons happened.
Okay.
And since that event, rather slightly before that, I've had the privilege to be a part of this litigation right from the scratch till the stage, till the landmark judgment came before the Supreme Court.
So you were in favor of Tata or Tata Sons?
So we were for the Tata Group, so to speak. We were for Tata Sons.
Okay.
And we were defending the judgment of removing the erstwhile chairman from the board.
So basically, it was like a company challenging a company's decision, removing a chairman.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. So just to give a very small backdrop about how the dispute broke out. Mm-hmm. I mean, you've all heard of the company Tata Sons. It is the parent company for all the Tata companies, which is either Tata Steel, Tata Motors, Tata Consultancy, etc. They all come under the parent company, which is Tata Sons. And Tata Sons has its own board of directors like any other company. And for the longest time, prior to Mr. Cyrus Mistry's appointment, there were only Tata family members who presided as the chairman. There were four chairmen before Cyrus Mistry. And Cyrus Mistry, in that sense, was the only chairman who was a non-Tata member. He was the fifth chairman of Tata Sons. Over time, perhaps there must have been some trust issues, etc., which led to the replacement of Mr. Mistry from the board. And when that happened on that fateful day, which is 24th of October 16, that's when I think litigation started happening between the main shareholders of Tata Sons. And that's how the matter came up before NCLT Mumbai. So the main, the shareholding of Tata Sons is divided into broadly three, four parts. And this is just a loose distinction. One, of course, is the Tata Trusts, which are the main benefactors of Tata Sons dividends. They are these institutions who help us in advancing science, etc. And they are charitable institutes. Then along with that, there are many, many Tata family members who are shareholders. And alongside them, there is the Mistry Group family, where Cyrus Mistry also is a shareholder. So once he was removed, or rather replaced is actually the correct term, from the post of chairmanship of Tata Sons, the shareholders of Tata Sons, which obviously includes Mr. Mistry and his companies, which were shareholders of Tata Sons, they started operation mismanagement litigation before NCLT Mumbai on the ground that our nominee, Mr. Cyrus Mistry, was replaced because he was pointing out to some operation mismanagement allegations in the company. And that is the reason why he was eventually replaced. So that litigation started off in NCLT. NCLT held it in favor of Tata Sons that this is not a case of operation mismanagement, nor are the legal ingredients met, and the facts also are not met. And after that, the matter came up before NCLAT, which is the appellate body, National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. There, the judgment was in favor of Cyrus Mistry Group, where they said that the chairman has been illegally removed and should be put back into his seat. This was challenged before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court finally held that the decision of NCLAT was not correct, the decision of NCLT was correct, and that the replacement of the previous chairman on account of trust issues is valid, it cannot be interfered with, and there is no operation mismanagement in the company. And while giving that 243-page judgment, they have laid out many principles on the jurisdiction of operation mismanagement under the Companies Act. So if you ever want to read about the development of the law of operation mismanagement, or what are the ingredients, what are the kind of allegations which amount to operation mismanagement, then perhaps that judgment is a good starting point.
Nice to know, Rohan. Any student has any questions here?
Yeah, Rohan, I have a question.
Yeah, hi.
So Rohan, since you said, since you obviously have previous experience working in a firm, I just wanted to know, when you get to a firm, or even for that matter, right? Do you choose your area practice, or are you assigned a specific area and then that's kind of fixed with you?
So in India, you can make a distinction between litigation and corporate. Beyond that, it's purely a function of what is the work that the team or your supervising partner has. And whatever work that person has is pretty much what you get to do. Be clear about whether you want to do litigation or corporate. That choice is completely up to you. But after that, if you want to do litigation, what kind of litigation, you might be able to filter some teams on the basis of what kind of work they are doing. But beyond that, the choice is not available. So you have to basically go by the work that your team partner or the supervising partner gets, and that is what you execute.
All right. And Rohan, just a follow-up question on that. So you said when you started off, or when you were with Shardul Amar Chand, you were mainly into tax, right?
Tax I was doing as part of economic laws practice, because they specialize in indirect tax litigation. And then I switched my field to commercial litigation when I joined Shardul Amar Chand.
Okay, because you know, generally when you tend to choose a particular area, especially in a firm or a corporate, whether it's in terms of mergers and acquisitions, real estate or employment law, just about any other thing, at least from my personal experience, I feel that you tend to be confined to that particular area because they tend to consider you a lot more expertised or experienced in that. So then changing to a different area becomes a little difficult because you're more or less considered to be a fresher. So it's not very easy, at least when you're working for a firm or a corporate. So when you decide to make that choice, what are the, you know, factors that you need to keep in consideration, you know, before you decide what exactly you need to choose?
Okay, no, that's a valid question. So let's say you started off doing employment law and now you've decided you want to pursue some other branch.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say you've finalized on what are the 2-3 areas that now you want to venture into. So the first and foremost consideration that you should have to keep in mind is that it's going to be slightly difficult because if there are people in the market who had experience in that very field that you're looking at, then obviously they might prefer their resume over yours. That's a challenge. But it's not a challenge which cannot be overcome. Number two, if at all you're lucky and you're fortunate to get your area of practice that you want, one should be mentally prepared that there's going to be a cutback in terms of your experience and maybe your remuneration as well, because they may not treat you at par with someone who's had experience in that line of work that you're working on. So these are certainly two criteria which you must focus on, or rather be prepared. But apart from that, if you know the person that you are, if you feel that you have a solid foundation and that you have the requisite skill set or the acumen, then that should get reflected in your resume to some extent and should be able to get you at least an interview potential employer, prospect employment, where at least you get to get a chance to convince them that you're either a quick learner or someone who can adapt really well, and you bring in the added advantage of some other field. So in litigation, at least the way I look at things, if someone's coming to me with, let's say, 6 years of experience in just one branch of law, versus someone who's had, let's say, 3 to 4 years in one set of law and then another 2-3 years, then I might be inclined to take someone who's got a breadth of experience.
Mm-hmm.
Because in litigation, at least, you need both the breadth as well as the depth of it. While depth can be developed by doing something consistently over a period of time, one doesn't get many options to develop breadth. That's perhaps the reality of things.
Madam, what's your name?
This is
Madeline, sir. Okay, Madeline. So I would just like to share our family firms. Here in my family, we take like various types of cases, starting from consumer forum litigation, civil litigation, property matters, criminal matters, service matters, labor matters, central government services, state government services, and even also company matters. It depends upon how the advocate gets exposure into different areas. Sometimes you may face a client who has litigation in several areas. Maybe he's not limited to one area. He has a business and he has to look into the labor side. He has to look into the business side. He has to look into the different areas. And suppose he entrusts you with such type of work, it's a sheer luck factor. You may get an exposure in several areas of practice. And sometimes in companies also, if you're working as a legal advisor for any company and they have several areas to look into, and they have not defined the advocate's ground limit, like for which area he has to look, then maybe it's a good chance that advocate may be pushed towards to look into different areas. It's just a factor which cannot be determined. So in our since past 30 years we have handled, we started with criminal practice when we started, and then the clients who had criminal background, they went into business ventures. It's just like by word of mouth we developed, and they gave us more cases into different litigation, company matters and other things. This is how a chain links, you have to develop yourself. And more important for students who are looking for corporate placements, the first thing is any company who wants to hire you, they want to see your exposure in the corporate field. How have you, where all have you interned? What is your internship certificates? What is your experience level? All these things matter. And if your curriculum vitae is matching with their requirement, then obviously you land the job. This is how it works. So mainly I students who ask me like, does your college give me placements? I always tell them that you should first prepare your CV with good internships with different corporate teams or anything when they're looking specifically into corporate litigation and other stuff. So Marilyn, any other things you want to know? Yeah.
No, that's all. Thank you.
So, yeah, Rohan, would you like to share something more about for students for 5 minutes?
Good. Yeah, thanks, Abhilash. In fact, I'd rather use the 5 minutes to understand the mindset of all of you, at least who've had the patience to bear with me till now. What is it that you're looking at? And anyone can ask that question. What is it after 3 years course that you want to go for? And that perhaps maybe I can use those 5 minutes to give my 2 cents about your query or what is it that you're looking at?
Rohan, this is Mahesh here. Apart from,
hi, Mahesh.
Good evening. Apart from academics, what are the other things that one need to focus on?
Other than
the academic curriculum for your course, what else one need to focus on?
Okay, that's a very good question actually, Mahesh. And I think Abhilash will know this really well. So there is a serious gap between what we are learning these days in colleges versus what is expected of any person who joins the profession. There's a huge gap. And I can recall my time when I graduated from my college. I thought I knew some bit of the law. But the moment I entered profession, I had to basically unlearn everything from the way we read law, from the way we approach law, to how we draft. Everything had to be unlearned and relearned. So the first and foremost requirement is that you have to be prepared mentally to go through a very different experience once you join law in terms of the profession itself. And college might prepare you. And I know, at least in this college, we are taking or adapting new means of learning, which is a bunch of practical side things and academics. So you guys would be well prepared. But for the general law, I felt that
yes, just to be
what we learn in college only gives us things.
Yes, I'm audible. Yeah, I'm audible. Yeah, this is my experiment. Yeah, I have started with all the students to share all the work I have been doing. So recently I shared all the defamation suits I have filed across with all the students, and the another writ appeal I have filed with all the students. Next week I'm like bringing my father to teach them about the revenue cases which will be filed before commissioner, assistant commissioner and district commissioner courts. So next week onwards, every weekend, like this is how I have planned to give the best of things for our students so that they learn the drafting aspects and they connect with the practical sense. Am I audible? My internet connection is showing unstable. am I audible now?
Well, I can hear you, Vilas.
Yes. Things are fine. You're audible.
Okay. So this is how I want to give back to all the students, because I understand like what is the things students miss when they go into practice. They again have to put in 2 years of hard effort to know each and every drafting things, each and every court's requirements. Every court will have its own requirement, how to draft the language part, what are the vocabulary you should use before each court while drafting. All those things I want to teach. I want to make our students from our college a special batch where experiment not conducted anywhere before in India. I would like to say that. So in that sense, I would like to train all our students so that they be well equipped to give a solution to any client they client that approach our students. So this is how I want to take, with everybody's help, with Rohan's help and many other friends. So we will be bringing Rohan again and again for many seminars in coming days for any doubts or anything on a particular topic. Maybe we can do a half an hour seminar, something like that. So I want all our students to be like more information should be shared so that they know better in hand. So it will just give a added advantage when they pass out from our college.
Absolutely. And just to add to what Abhilash said, and I think Abhilash used a very, very important term, which is providing solutions. And that's the key difference. When we are in college, our entire focus is actually on absorbing the law, understanding what it is. The difference in being in college and in your practice is that you have to use that very law to solve a problem. So the way you look at law, the way you read at law, obviously changes. You also require different kind of skill set in drafting, as Abhilash rightly mentioned. And that is why there is a huge gap in terms of what we are taught in colleges versus what happens practically. And I think that's up to the brilliant institutes we have in India, just like this one, to decide how much of that practical knowledge can be brought in. See, what I felt is, I am not sure whether every bit of that can be brought in, because ultimately people who are getting introduced to law have to know the law first as a starter, but perhaps more case studies can be brought in, more moot courts can happen, more guest lectures can happen, some kind of internship which stands beyond 1 month can happen, because there's only so much one can learn. So these are perhaps some tweaks we can bring to our curriculum to make sure that the bridge or the deficit between practice and procedure here is not that wide.
I would like to wind up the session. Thank you, Rohan, very much. Anyone would like to tell a few words, word of thanks? Krupa, anyone in the group would like to share?
Quick thoughts. This is Mahesh here.
Yes.
For me, it was a wonderful session. It's a kind of eye-opener for me. Even though I joined late, but the amount of value I got out of those few minutes is really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mahesh.
Thank you, Mahesh. I think, Abhilash, you are using your position to make them say good words about me.
I would like to share a few words. First of all, Abhilash, thank you for organizing this, and also to our guest here. Thank you very much. I know that my interests are not aligned with this session. However, it has been very useful because I do not have the exposure. Like you said, networking is very important. So this is the first time I'm actually speaking to a lawyer. So, I mean, other than our faculty, though, so it's been very nice to know the world from your perspective, from what you've seen. And I really thank you for your time and for all that you've shared with us. And also, Abhilash, thank you for the initiative that you've taken for us to guide us like this. I really appreciate it.
Actually, Rohan, people are in my age group and they're elder to me. I cannot use my position in a way to like compulsively. I cannot treat them as a student. I have to treat them as a fellow human being and with all due respects, as whatever like his elder had to treat him the way. So I treat my students in a way that they feel very comfortable learning in our college. This is how I want it to be. So they should not feel any tension to learn in our college. We have provided like a very free ground for everybody to learn law. But along with that, I always advise them that reading, getting a degree does not make you a successful lawyer. It is your exposure what is required in the field. So, Krupa, you want to share a few words?
Hi, Rohan. It was very informative. I was really waiting for this kind of session. So, I have informed sometimes to Vilasar as well. So, thanks a lot for your precious time. It's looking forward to have this kind of session in the future as well.
Thank you so much, Krupa, for your time.
Thank you, Abhilash and Rohan. Rohan, I thought that everybody would want to say thank you and this wouldn't happen. But thank you for the opportunity, Abhilash, to let Rohan know that we were thinking that law is just a 3-year course and then we would know. But through your eyes, we have seen what we would be facing when we actually finish our course. So it has been very enlightening and very encouraging. Thank you so much, Rohan. You have no idea what kind of information we needed. You have given it to us. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Thank you, Abhilash.
Thank you, Gulsan.
Sir, another thing. I would like to thank Rohan for this one particular thing. So we all read these landmark judgments on website or on books or anything. But this is the first time it felt like we were part of a landmark judgment, because the way he explained the facts and how everything happened, the background and the judgment, and to also, you know, be along with him in his experience, because from scratch he was part of that case. So it's not coming from any textbook or somebody's blog, but actually from a person who was there. So it was incredible, and congratulations on the case.
Thank you, Priya, for your
time. Okay. So, Pankaj, yeah, thanks for joining, especially on a Sunday evening. And in spite of a hectic schedule, what you said, you're still in office. Thanks for joining. And thanks for summarizing.
Actually, I'm pushing the sessions to stop because Rohan has to appear tomorrow for a case before Supreme Court, and he's he has a session with Venugopal, senior advocate in Supreme Court. That's why I'm like pushing the session forward. Otherwise, I could have taken this for 2 hours. Okay. But anyways, it was a wonderful session, Rohan. Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you both.
Thank you both. Thank you, Abhilash sir. Thank you, Rohan sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Yeah, Pushpanjali, you have a question?
Not a question, sir. Actually, I would like to thank Rohan, sir, and first of all, you. But as you said, running out of time, sir, will be busy. So I just wanted to say thank you. That's all. But or else I would have picked a little. But as a student, actually, as a student, you are helping us a lot, sir. We are really, I don't know how to express my words, but really, we are very lucky to have a person like you as our teacher. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you very much.
Welcome, madam.
And thank you very much, Rohan, sir.
Thank you so much, Pushpanjali. And I think with this, I should take the opportunity to thank all of you who've had the patience to bear with me for all this time, and most of all to Abhilash for thinking of me, that I could be a person who could bring some value add to all of you. And I hope I did in that limited time of that. And
you actually did more than what we were expecting, and we should be thankful for the entire time whenever we have to fall upon any idea of any practice of Supreme Court. We only think about a point where what you had told us about the AOR practice and your experience in commercial law. Thank you very much, Rohan.
Thank you, Abhilash. Good evening to all.
Good evening. Thank you. I'll end the session. Yep. Thank you, Rohan.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Good evening.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.